fiction, science fiction, horror, fantasy, crime, LGBT thriller.
You have now entered the House of Mystery with your hosts, Eric Shapiro, David North Martino, John Copenhaver, and Al Warren.
Heard on KCPA 106.5 FM Los Angeles,
102.3 FM Riverside,
and 1050 AM Palm Springs.
The writer is Brian Whitney. How you doing, Brian?
Good. Thanks for having me on, you guys.
So now, let's just start out basically. An incel mass murderer. So what is an incel?
Well, an incel is short for the involuntarily celibate, which means just as it sounds. Most incels, if not all, true incels, believe there can't be any female incels. Most of them don't even believe there can be any homosexual incels. It's a straight male that's never had sex. So that's basically, and there's huge subcultures right now, like out there, like that have different websites and chat rooms where incels gather together and talk about their plight.
But okay, so I'm confused. So now they say, I can never have sex. Is that? Why?
They have never had sex. Like, that's the first thing, of course, is that they have never had sex. But yes, it's also that they feel that they will basically never have sex, and for a variety of reasons. And they dislike men also, who they feel do have a lot of sex, so they refer to as chads. And again, they sort of support, it's kind of was a support group at first, but it formed into something a lot more odd and different over the years.
Yeah. Well, you know, but I'm just trying to get this, because if, you know, we talk about Elliot Rodger, and he's kind of the person in your book.
Right.
And he's considers himself to be intelligent, refined,
yes,
handsome, fashionable, right, and charming. Yet women pay no attention to him. See, that in itself doesn't make sense, because if there's a good-looking, smart, handsome man that dresses well,
right,
and is well-groomed, and he walks through the mall, you know, girls are going to check him out.
And he would walk through the mall a lot, wanting girls to check him out. So he thinks that women are just drawn to, he's not alive anymore, he thought that women were just drawn to what he would call obnoxious brutes, the lower levels of society, the type of men that would pick on him, of course, when he was growing up, and that women don't like refined gentlemen such as himself. They like idiotic men, macho, stupid men, basically.
Wow. So I'm still kind of not getting why he wouldn't search out the right woman.
Well, he's, okay, so he and incels in general are a little bit different, because a lot of incels, they don't consider themselves handsome. They don't think that they're good looking. They feel that they don't have a girlfriend purely because of those two things. Elliot, the weird thing about Elliot, well, there's a lot of weird things about Elliot, but one of the weird things about him, he never actually approached any woman. Like, he just would kind of like walk around, look at women in his expensive sunglasses and expect them to come up to him. That's one. But two, he also only wanted to have a very beautiful, beautiful, he always wanted to said blonde, but a beautiful blonde woman. So in reality, if an average looking woman or even an above average looking woman approached him, he probably wouldn't have been interested. So he thought that he should have had, you know, the most beautiful woman in the world, and he never even had a girlfriend or had sex. And he became angry about these things. There's a lot of misfiring synapses going on in his brain, obviously. This isn't like really a normal thing for anyone to think, but that is the way he thought.
Did anyone show him how to use Tinder? Or?
No, I mean, well, so this happened in 2014, and he didn't do Tinder. What he would do is he would put up YouTube videos of himself, like driving an expensive car with music in the background to kind of show people how attractive and cool he was, and then people would kind of laugh at them, and then he'd get really angry. Is kind of how that went.
Mm. So now, what? So, but his intention when he put those videos up was to attract a woman, wasn't it? Or
yeah, it was. But in real life, he didn't have any friends at all. Zero. He didn't have any sort of even social acquaintances. And he would just kind of hide in his room and occasionally just drive his car around or sit outside on a bench and wait for a woman to approach him because he was so handsome and refined and so on and so forth.
Well, that sounds like me.
How'd it work out for you?
It hasn't. I've got two dogs.
Yeah.
What do these groups do? Like you say that there's groups, so he joins other incels, as he calls himself. And what do they talk about in their groups, do you know?
Well, I do, but two parts, though. So he honestly really didn't do much of that. Like he would get online and he would there were like these pickup artist sites, and he would get on those and he would kind of troll them and say mean things to them and so on and so forth. So he wasn't really involved with other incels so much. He wasn't really involved with anybody. But nowadays, yes, there's one called incels.co, which is the biggest one. I interviewed the person that runs that site for the book, actually. And that one's just, it's a very active site. They were kicked off Reddit. They used to be on Reddit, but they were kicked off because of threatened violence and misogyny and things of that nature. And if you get kicked off Reddit, then it's pretty it's pretty bad. You know, so they started their own website. There's a few, but this is the most popular one. And there's just a variety of posts about, you know, about how awful women are, about how they can never get laid. They call Elliot Rodger, some of them call Elliot Rodger Saint Elliot. And they talk about, like, you know, when they talk about getting violent because of what they perceive the world has done to them, they call it going ER, which is Elliot Rodger's initials are ER, obviously. So, it's a weird place. The Southern Poverty Law Center have called them out as like alt-right hate group. So they say some pretty weird things, mostly obviously against women.
Wow. So let's talk about this Elliot Rodger. What did he plan on doing, and why?
Well, he was he was a very, very shy kid. He was picked on, and, you know, he kept kind of thinking that if he just had a girlfriend, that everything would be better and so on and so forth. But he never had a girlfriend all through junior high and high school. And he went to college in Santa Barbara, and he thought then that he was definitely going to find a girlfriend because he was in college. And then that didn't happen. So then, as time went on, he became more and more isolated and just did talking about doing what he called his day of retribution, where he would get back at everybody who had wronged him, men and women, over the years, and kill all sorts of people, which he ended up following through on, and he ended up killing six people in what's known as the Isla Vista Massacre in 2014.
So now, he wanted to kill both men and women. So which men was he after?
Well, he wanted to kill, this is like such a bizarre thing to even talk about in this concept. And I remember when I did the Magnata show, like I giggled a few times. So I don't think that this stuff is funny, but it's so bizarre. So he wanted to kill the beautiful woman that had spurned him, and he also wanted to kill the men, the type of man that they were attracted to. And then to do so, he wanted to lure them into his apartment, which he was going to make a torture chamber. And to do so, he had to kill, in his mind, he had to kill his roommates, so his apartment would be empty so he could lure these people into his torture chamber. So he also killed three of his roommates who weren't really the type of guy that he disliked. They were just you know, these nerdy roommates, in his words, nerdy roommates, that just had to be taken out so he could go forward with his plan.
Wow. So he actually killed his three of his roommates. But if he kills
them,
how is he going to
get rent? Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, how is he going to get rent?
Well, his cash paid his rent. He wasn't even in college anymore. He had dropped out of college, and his parents still thought he was in college because he was lying to them. So they paid for his college and spending money and rent. And so I know you're joking, but yeah, so he was fine in that matter.
Well, that's good. That's important.
Yeah.
So how did he kill his roommates? Like, what did he do to them? Like,
Well, there was actually, I said roommates, so there were two roommates and another one that was a friend, and he stabbed them one by one when they came home, meaning he'd stabbed one, and then he dragged them into a room and put towels over them, and he stabbed the next. And this is the guy who's like, I don't know his exact weight and height, but he's like about 5'4", maybe he was about 5'4", maybe 135, never had been violent in his life, like had never done anything violent before, so... He one by one he stabbed the three people and then put them in a room with blankets and towels over them and so on and so forth.
Wow. So then his next move, he was going to go out and how was he going to get people back to his apartment and torture them?
Well, so he was going to lure them in, but then after he did this, because see the thing is, as we talk about this, I don't know if you guys are aware, but Elliot Rodger wrote a manifesto called My Twisted World. So it's a very long manifesto, and you can find it on the net. It's not published anywhere for obvious reasons. But so when I say this stuff, I mean, this is all actually coming from him, you know. So at that point, he realized that he had three corpses in his apartment, and one, he'd never been able to lure a woman into his apartment, even when he didn't have three corpses in there, you know, which is part of the reason that he's in this situation in the first place. So instead he decides to go out and just start, he abandons that part of his plan for the torture chamber. And he decides to go out and just start taking revenge, on these people.
Well, a bit late for the people in his apartment that are dead.
Yeah, no, I know, very much so.
So how would he, what was his intent, and what was he going to do to these people that he found?
God, I mean, you're asking these questions and it's like, okay, so the people that he found, he was going to torture, he was going to torture them, and then he was going to kill them. And then this was like a really big thing for him. He was going to put their heads in bags and then bring the bags with him when he went out to the next part of his plan, which was to go just kill people in the town of Isla Vista, not just people, but women in particular sororities and so on and so forth. And then he was going to dump the heads. He was going to dump the heads on the street to show everyone how powerful he was when he started doing such things. And this is actually what he wrote as his plan.
Wow.
It wasn't a very good plan, you know,
so-
obviously.
So he did some things before he did the killings, too. He did some strange things as well.
Yeah, we kind of jumped past that. So, yeah, like he started doing a lot of things where he would drive past. Once, like, he drove past a couple attractive women, and he smiled at them, and they just kind of looked away and rolled their eyes. So then he drove back, and he threw his like Starbucks latte on their pants and then drove off. Another time he was at a park and there were a bunch of jocks, as he would call them, playing football, and a bunch of young women that he thought were very attractive laying around them. And he got so mad, because that's the thing, he would get incredibly mad. Like whenever he would just even see an attractive woman with a guy, he'd get incredibly angry. So he went to a store, I think he went to a Walmart, and he bought like a Super Soaker and he filled it with orange juice. And then he went back and ran up to the men and the women and sprayed them with a Super Soak with orange juice, and they ran away and got back in his car. So for a period of time, he was doing a lot of different things like this, like random bizarre things where he would, you know, throw coffee on people and so on and so forth and speed off in his car. Not just people, but always attractive women or attractive women and a guy that he saw. So there's a period of about a year he was doing stuff like this.
I do that now.
It's such a weird case. I was amazed that nobody ever wrote about it before, to be honest with you, because, I mean, I the case is, like, top-of-the-line weird.
Yeah.
Weird.
Well, I first heard about it, incels. Wasn't that the guy in Toronto that ran over people?
Yeah.
And he was...
Before he did, he was writing on Facebook, like, you know, things like Alec Manassian, I believe his
name.
That's
him,
yep. Like, you know, yeah. I never know how to pronounce his last name, which is, you know, he's in the book, but But anyway, he wrote The Incel Rebellion has Begun. He referenced Elliot Rodger a bunch of times. You know, there's been other guys, too, that have done lesser things, but Manassian's the next biggest one after Rodger, I would say.
Well, I'm trying to get, like, if they do a... write on Facebook and they do manifestos and they're really into this, what is the outcome that they expect? Like at the end, when they go out killing people and showing them how powerful they are and doing all of this damage, what is the end game?
Well, Elliot knew he was going to die. He ended up shooting himself in the head after he went on his little rampage after he killed the three roommates. And he wrote a lot about that in his manifesto about like how he kept hoping, oh, if I just found a girlfriend, I won't have to do this. I won't have to do this. I won't have to die. And he kept trying to do, he'd play the lottery all the time because like, oh, if I got rich, you know, women like rich guys. So if I got rich, I mean, I say all the time, I mean, he played it obsessively. Just like, if I got rich, then I won't have to kill everybody because then I'll get rich and I'll have a beautiful woman. But when he finally did this, cause he was planning it for months. Like at one point he hurt himself and he was like, I'm not ready to do it. He was prepared to die. He was like, I can't be arrested. I'm going to die. So, Manassian, he's in prison and I'm not really sure like what his goal is. There's another guy in Florida, Scott Beerley, B-I-E-R-L-E. He's a guy in Tallahassee that was arrested a bunch of times for grabbing women's butts, and then he went into a yoga studio and shot up the yoga studio. He shot himself, too. He killed himself. There's a guy named Chris Harper Mercer. He killed himself. He went to a college in Oregon, killed some people, and he killed himself. So other than Manassian, I think, I don't know.
So they're kind of thinking they're going to die anyway. So I guess
their anger is just so much at this point. Like Elliot was just so angry, and he really felt that he was right. He really felt that humanity had wronged him, and he didn't want to do this, and so on and so forth. And that he didn't have a choice, and it really bizarre, very very bizarre.
Well, he was a weird looking dude. Like I understand. Maybe that's where he's coming from. He knows he's a weird looking dude. He's got strange looking jaw and mouth and all that kind of stuff. So I really have a hard time with this guy because I'm not entirely sure about whether he was even honest with himself about who he was.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's kind of what I was alluding to. So again, I mean, what I find really, there's a lot of things interesting, but this guy and a lot of other guys, like he would not, meaning Elliot, he would not meet or ask out or want to have sex with an average looking woman. You know, that wasn't anything that he was interested in at all. In fact, if he knew a guy was like having sex that he knew, if the guy was having sex with a woman that Elliot didn't deem incredibly attractive, it made him feel better. He was like, well, I would never do that. You know, I wouldn't sink so low to have sex with somebody like that. So yeah, just a lot of like, you know, things going on in his brain that just were not lining up, you know?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Sure. I see him and I see what you mean. I'm looking at pictures of him online. So but he's not real. Like, you don't look at him and go, oh, my God, that's awful. Like,
No.
No.
I just sort of think that, So what's his background? Where's his family and situation, and how did he grow up? Was there some sort of problem when he was still a child or early teenager?
Well, no. I mean, well, two things. Like, one, his background is that his father is a guy named Peter Rodger, who was like a second director in The Hunger Games, and he did like a movie called Oh My God with a question mark, Oh My God, question mark, which was, he put out himself. It didn't do very well, but he came from money. He was definitely like, if he wasn't quite rich, he was almost rich. And his parents got divorced and his father remarried. But there really wasn't anything like about his background other than the fact that you know, he definitely has some mental health issues, obviously. And he was diagnosed with being on the autism spectrum, and he definitely had some OCD things, but as time went, this is when he was very young and small, and he was incredibly shy. Like, he wouldn't talk in school, and he was very, very quiet. But there wasn't anything that would lead anybody to think that he was going to do anything like this. And as I said, he was completely isolated to the extent that when he did see his parents, he just completely lied to them about everything and said, oh, everything's fine, and so on and so forth. But no one knew anything about what was really going on with him.
Right. I just wonder because, it's just how you can grow up and go through your whole teenage years and all that stuff. And nobody, you know, he never hooked up with anybody, you know, or didn't have close friends and stuff, but I guess it happens.
Well, I mean, he would occasionally, so they knew something was going on with him, to the extent that, you know, at one point he was in school and he had a panic attack in the hallway, and, you know, I'm getting back to your point in a second, but so they knew something was going on, but they just thought, you know, he was shy and, you know, but he occasionally would have friends, but then he would sort of drive the friends away by acting very bizarrely, in large part even about the female thing, where he'd be at a restaurant with a friend or whatever, and a attractive woman would come in with a boyfriend, and he'd get really angry and start saying really weird things. So he would drive his friends away, you know, because he was so weird.
Right. Any chance he was gay?
I would say definitely not. I mean, he's so, like, I'm not even recommending you do read the manifesto, but, I mean, it's 123,000 words long, and, like, 90,000 of them are basically about him being obsessed with women, so I don't think so.
Wow, what a story. So now, when he killed all these people, was it all in one day, or let's talk about that.
Yeah, well, so after he did what he did, and after he killed the two roommates and their friend, then he kind of hung out with them for the night, and then the next day he uploaded his video, which is you can find on the internet, but he put up a video basically saying what he was going to do, and at the same point as he put up the video is really creepy. I mean, it's kind of internet famous in a sense, but people always take it down and then someone else will put it back up because it's disturbing. He basically says, okay, now you've ruined my life, and now I'm going to kill all the women and men who look down on me, and so on and so forth. Then he sent his manifesto to his parents, his life coach, because he had a life coach, and one or two other people. And
well, that's what you want to proofread your manifesto, I guess, your life.
Yeah, exactly. So then he went out. At the same point that he goes out, of course, his mother gets the manifesto. She freaks out, calls his father. They're divorced at the time. So they all start driving to Santa Barbara, you know, and they call the police. And so the first thing he does is he goes to a sorority, because he had this big plan that he was going to go to the sorority where all the hottest women lived and go in and kill all of them. So he knocks on the door and, like, no one answers, you know, like, they don't let him in. So he's out there for like, 5 minutes or something, literally, like, knocking on the door and no one lets him in. So then he's like, what the hell, you know, like, first my torture chamber idea, like, went wrong. And now, like, you know, no one's going to let me into the sorority. So then he basically just started shooting random people on the street. He shot three women, one of whom died, like, right away. And then he drove down the street. He shot another guy that was in the deli. He started hitting people with his car, sideswiping people with his car, like running over bicyclists, so on and so forth. So it went from this thing that he was going to, do this very designed plan to him just driving down the streets like a madman, like shooting at anything that moved. A bunch of police came to the scene. They shot at him. One of them hit him in the hip. He crashed into a car, and then he shot himself in the head. And he killed three people. He killed six entirely, counting the three that he killed before he went out on the rampage. And wounded, I'm going to be off a little bit, but it was like maybe 17, 18, 19 people.
Hmm. Does his life coach still have a job?
Boy.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, he lied to everybody, so that's the thing. I mean, he lied to absolutely everybody, and I don't think he really saw his life coach very often, to be honest with you, but yeah.
I always feel like these guys, you know, they go out and go on a rampage and then take care of themselves. I think they should probably start there, and that would be the end of it.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's a very odd story. And as I mentioned, like when it happened, he's one of these people that myself and some of my friends, because we're a weird bunch, like, you know, true crime writers often are, but like I was very aware of him, and he's somebody that I've been aware of for quite a while, and there's a lot of other people that have no idea, you know, who he is at all. But the story itself is definitely one of the more odd, massacre spree killer kind of stories that I've heard. He's one of a kind.
So is that what attracted you to the story in the first place?
Yeah, well, I think the incel thing too. I mean, if you go on the website, it's just so bizarre, and I've always been kind of interested in subcultures in general, but yeah, I mean, it was the first book I ever wrote in this genre was with Gil Valley's the Cannibal Cop, and it was the same thing. I remember I was just reading about it, and I was like, this is just fascinating, you know. So there's certain ones, and Elliot Rodger's another one that it just stuck in my head.
I interviewed Gil. I talked.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. You did. Yeah. That's right. You did. Yeah. Yeah. When that book came out. Yeah. I still am in touch with Gil, believe it or not. He's also an interesting character, but
yeah,
one
yeah.
that never actually did anything, you know?
Yeah. I just thought about it.
Right.
I'm looking at their website right now, and there's 1,288 people online right now, 11,000 members and 2.6 million posts.
Well, yeah.
That's a lot of angry guys.
Yeah, and if you look, I mean, if you maybe I can pull it up because my laptop's right here too. But I mean, it's just a variety of posts
But do you think this is something that's new to us in society, or is this something that before the web it was still going on, but we just didn't realize it, or?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I think the other thing is too is obviously there are a lot of people that are involuntarily celibate that aren't incels, so to speak, where a lot of people will be like, well, that's a situation and not a movement, and that's totally true. I mean, there's all sorts of men and women out there but again, they believe that there aren't any, these guys don't believe there are any incel women, because they're like, a woman can have sex anytime they want, in their opinion. So, I mean, it's a good question, because I think back in the day, you were just like, oh, I'm a virgin, and I wish I wasn't, and you kind of kept that to yourself.
Right.
In my experience, anyway. People wouldn't come right out and talk about it. In this situation, a lot of people have gathered together, and in theory are supporting each other, but at the same point, they're supporting each other often by saying some pretty horrible things.
Well, I just wonder, because back in the old days, in the 60s and 70s, she always had that the guy that was a bachelor and never got married, and they always thought, well, you know, he's probably gay, but nobody talked about that. I wonder if some of them were incels, and they just left them alone, but maybe they were.
Right, I mean, and that's possible. I mean, with Elliot, again, is like, you know, he was just obsessed with. There's always a beautiful blonde woman, you know. It was never even a brunette, you know. He was just, you know, but you're right in the sense of, like, you know, yeah, back then it would be, you know, the internet's changed everything in that sort of way. And of course, like, most of these guys, a lot of these guys anyway, are just trolling. I mean, they get on the internet and they're just messing with people. And the fact that somebody might read their stuff and be blown away by it is exactly what they're looking for. So, I mean, they're not all serious when they say the things that they say about women or violence or so on and so forth. But then somebody like Elliot or like Manassian comes along and then you go, oh, some of these guys are serious, you know, and it becomes,
So has law enforcement sort of taken this on and sort of, do they keep an eye on incels, or do they think about that, or do you think it's just a...
Yeah, I mean, they do. There's you know, it's definitely something that is monitored, and I'm sure there's a lot of people on this website that are fake, even, you know, monitoring the website and so on and so forth. And it's also the kind of thing where sometimes somebody even gets identified as a Nicholas Cruz, for example, the Parkland shooter.
Right.
Like, he said a couple things about Elliot Rodger. I mean, Elliot Rodger is, like, referenced by, like, so many different school shooters and so on and so forth, but he said a few things on Facebook about Elliot Rodger and so on and so forth. So some people consider him to be an incel killer, where he obviously had a myriad of different things that were going on with him. It wasn't just, you know, a woman don't like me. So it's kind of spread, and it's something that I'm sure law enforcement keeps an eye on at this point.
But do you see this to be a growing problem, or do you think it's just going to fade away?
I mean, I tend to be the kind of person that, you know, I mean, as we've talked about, even, like, you know, me talking about Gil, and Gil and I are friends, you know, so I'm not the most judgmental person, if you know, obviously. So in this kind of situation, I don't even know if it's a growing problem. I think what happens is the more the media, you know, kind of makes it into a growing problem, the more it might be a growing problem. I mean, there's not like scores of incels, like, marching down the street, like, committing, like, violent crimes. It's just been a handful, but it's certainly jarring when somebody... There was a guy named George Sodini, like, years ago, that was kind of considered the OG incel, that before, like, you know, even, like, you know, that wrote a lot on a blog about how he was going to kill women because no woman liked him. That's the overarching theme, is that these guys are going to do this because women don't like them. I mean, that's sort of like the, you know, the, as far as the crime aspect of the incel thing goes. But since Elliot Rodger, I mean, he's been referenced numerous times, and that's all in the book too. In the last chapter, I go through the other, you know, so-called incel murderers, or people that attempted murder, and they all referenced Elliot Rodger or incels or so on and so forth. But it's hard to tell how much of it's, because it's the internet, it's hard to tell how much of it's really the reason and how much of it's them just, like, playing around. With Elliot, it was really the reason. With Manassian, I would also say it was really the reason.
Wow. Just finding out so many things about so many people that we didn't know about just from by having the internet, you know?
Yeah, well, that's definitely true. I mean, it's a good question to ask if it's a bigger problem, because it's a bigger problem just because of the internet. I mean, back in the day, it wouldn't be something that you would feel emboldened by, you know, to talk to, like, another, you know, whatever number is, like, another 10,000 people,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
kind of egging you on and saying, oh, I get what you're saying. You know, back then you wouldn't even tell your friends that you were a virgin. You would kind of try to keep it under your hat.
Right. You know? They'd laugh at you. right? So
yeah, they would. when I was growing up, they definitely would. I mean, you know, I didn't, you know, before I lost my virginity, I didn't go around like telling everybody how hard it was to lose my virginity. It just wasn't done.
I didn't think you'd lost it yet.
Oh man,
it was actually last Sunday. But yeah, oh.
This whole movement is now a hitch in that process of, you know, having your that sort of embarrassment as you grow up. Now you find a community and you kind of get stuck there.
Yeah, and they're also, just as an anecdote, they're also a lot of these guys. So there might be a guy that says he's an incel and he goes on a podcast or something. And then if you look at the website or other websites, they'll be like, well, that guy said he had a girlfriend in seventh grade. I'm not making this up. Yeah. There's a guy that just happened with. So he's not an incel. Like, you know, it's almost like this exclusive club now where then they'll even say, oh, you're not an incel. Like, you know, you kissed somebody like when you were 12. You know, it's very, very black and white to the real hardcore guys.
Wow. Whole new little subculture going on. And nobody called
me. Yeah, never let it down.
Nobody called me. I should have been there.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
I know.
Yeah. Well, this is quite the book. So now the book is coming out. It's called The Gentleman Killer. Where do you plan on going after this?
I've got a couple things. I've always had a couple things that I'm working on. You know, it's just sort of the nature of the, as you know, it's the nature of the business. You just have to keep, you have to keep active. But yeah, the book comes out on the 17th. So, I'm just going to like bust it for a little bit, like trying to promote it. And then just keep working on my other projects and see where they go. It's hard. Cause you know, it's like, I've got one thing I'm working on that I'm like kind of shopping right now and I can't really like come out and say it, you know? But it's weird, you know, it's another odd book.
Good.
Writing about me. Wow. Now, do you have a website now? I don't remember. Do you have a website people can go
to? I do. It's brianwhitneyauthor.com. I do have a website.
Okay. We'll have that linked up. We'll have the book linked up. So people,
awesome.
If you want a really good book, buy it. Well, fantastic. Thank you for being here. Our guest is Brian Whitney.
Thanks, you guys. I really appreciate it.
To find out more about our show, guests, or to listen to past shows from our archive, please go to www.houseofmysteryradio.com.
The mission has been completed.
The end!
By George, he's got it! It is the end!
I'll see you.
If you're lying to me, I'll be back.
This has been a production of Something Weird Media.